now it is 10:05. This lecture, Professor Zhang will talk about moral dependence more. In this lecture, he will try to make some kind of argument for the dependence relation between neophytes and necrophytes. I got the first draft, but Professor has an updated version of a draft. So in the lecture, he will mention the difference. So let's welcome Nick to the
Thank you very much. It's nice to drink hot water. It's very refreshing. It's not in my country we have tea, but we don't just drink hot water, but it's very nice. Okay, so today is a very metaphysical class, and tomorrow will be more down to earth, or more to do with actual moral life. But today is very basically it's completely metaphysics today. It's not you'll see. So it's about, I've been talking about dependence a lot, but today I'm really going to talk about necessity. So I distinguish the two, but I'm talking about necessary connections. And it's basically the idea that there are necessary connections between moral facts and natural facts, or non-moral facts. There's a necessary connection. And these are often described in terms of a complicated word in English, which is supervenience. Supervenience. It's a very complicated word, it goes on a long time. Made famous by a philosopher called Yeogwon Kim, a Korean philosopher who emigrated to the United States, who's quite elderly now. But he was doing some other course, and his flatmate was doing philosophy, and he was visiting from Korea in the United States. And he thought, I can do that. So he changed course and became a famous philosopher. But the idea is that there are these necessary connections between the moral and the natural. So we've talked a lot about dependence, the natural properties or natural facts, and the moral facts. And I've used this symbol, but this is really what in philosophy we would use the square symbol, and that means necessity. We usually use a square to mean necessary, and we use this to mean possible.
Okay.
This is something called modal logic, which I think is a good thing, not to be replaced by quantification or possible worlds. That approach also Kripke. I think that misses a lot of things. So. This is relevant, these connections are relevant to a theory called non-naturalism. So non-naturalism is the theory associated with G.E. Moore, who we've come across. And on this theory, there really are moral properties and moral facts, but they are not identical with natural facts. So you've got moral facts, for example, something having a moral property. And there are natural facts, something having the natural property. And then the idea is that there might be these connections between them, but there's no identity between moral and natural facts. That's the idea. So it's often thought to be a kind of realism, and a very weird, strange one, because you've got the natural facts, and then there's this other realm of properties and facts kind of above, or these value properties which are somehow connected to the ordinary natural world, but they're different. So it's a kind of strange relation. You have this all over in many places in philosophy, especially with the mind and the brain. You've got this idea that we all have a brain, and our mind is somehow emerges from the brain, but is not the same thing. It's a kind of new reality, but it's not just a straightforward identity. It's kind of a new reality is created, but it's somehow still dependent or fixed by the brain. So in many areas of philosophy, you get this temptation to hold this view, where you deny the identity, because often there are reasons to deny identity, and yet you don't want to say they're completely separate and having nothing to do with each other. You want to say there are necessary connections. So one necessary connection would be that if you have two things, if you've got... So suppose you've got something... you've got two things, and one of them has a moral property, and you've got another thing, Y, and it does not have that same moral property. You know that there must be some natural property in which they differ. You know immediately from this combination, two different things, that there's some natural property that one has and the other doesn't have. So where there's a moral difference between things, there must be a natural difference. Or if two things are naturally very similar, if that was possible, if you've got nx, say that's a very inclusive property, and also you've got something, the other thing has the same property, then you know that if one has a moral property, then so does the other. So it seems that there are, if two things are very similar, then if one's got a moral property, so does the other. So if you've got two paintings, for example, think in terms of beauty, you've got two paintings here and here. If one is beautiful, then so is the other, because there's no relevant difference between them. And one is over here and one is over there, but that's not a relevant difference. Similarly, if you've got two actions, say stealing something, okay, one might be on a Tuesday and one might be on a Wednesday, but if everything is similar between them, necessarily, if one is wrong, then so is the other. So this is, you sum up with this notion of supervenience. Also, you can do it in terms of time. If something changes morally, then it must change naturally. So, but then the thought is there are these necessary connections, and yet there are no identities. And that's the puzzle. That's the problem, because it seems like you've got a strange combination. No identity, but necessity. So how can those two fit together? That's the problem. So a lot of people think that this problem is so big that it shows that Moore's view is no good. A lot of people think this is a big problem. So it's Simon Blackburn thought this, and many other people think this, and a lot of people are writing about this now, and they think that it makes a problem, these necessities make a problem for this kind of non-naturalist metaphysics of moral properties. So it seems like there are these puzzles about this connection. Right. And it's part of an argument, and it's part of the way in which people think that this theory is strange or weird or peculiar or a crazy theory to hold. Okay. So there's a problem of explaining these necessary connections. But how do you explain a necessary connection? How would you explain that? What would it mean to explain a necessity? Why is 2 and 2 necessarily 4? What is it? What are you trying to do? So I want to mention one thing before we go on, which is just because it's very common in the 20th century, that some people think you can have a conceptual explanation of a necessity. Very common to think this all the way through the 20th century. You explain necessities by appealing to our concepts. I find that a very strange idea, because you've got a necessary connection between things in the world explained in terms of concepts which refer to those things. So it's a strange idea. I mean, suppose you've got two facts here. You've got fact one and fact two, or two properties. So that's the world. And you've got concepts here, concept one and concept two. So there's supposed to be some sort of, you're supposed to somehow explain this necessary connection here, going in one direction or the other, in terms of some necessary connection between these concepts. So I don't really understand that. It just seems like irrelevant to what you want to explain. This is, I suppose, in the background here is Kripke. Necessity is something, a metaphysical idea. There's a connection between things or properties or facts in the world. Concepts are something semantic, or something to do with our mind. So how can what's going on in my mind, even what's going on necessarily in my mind, have anything to do with this connection between things in the world? It's an odd idea. So here's an example, though, a very common example. It's thought that necessarily a bachelor is an unmarried man. So there's supposed to be, that's the truth about the necessity in the world. And many people want to say, well, it's because there's a conceptual connection between between the concept of a bachelor and the concept of an unmarried man. And that explains the necessity that a bachelor is an unmarried man. So if we find someone and I say, are you married? Are you married? I don't know. And he'll say no. So we know it necessarily follows that he's not married and he's male, he's a bachelor. Okay. So there's this necessary connection, but that's explained by a connection in our concepts. But surely the answer is the reason is that a bachelor is a conjunctive property. So really, being a bachelor is having two properties, F and G. Mm-hmm. And a conjunction entails a conjunct. So he's unmarried and he's male, so it follows that he's unmarried. So a bachelor is unmarried, is explained by one concept being conjunctive, and the other concept, one property being just conjunctive, and the other property being a conjunct of that conjunctive property. Do people all have basic logic here? They do, good. Yeah. So I don't see that concepts really come into it, even in the case of a bachelor and unmarried man. And of course, I mean, maybe in the 20th century, why did people go for this strange theory? Well, I suppose they were desperate. Desperation for some theory of necessity and some theory of our knowledge of it. But it's, and so that's maybe why the logical positivists went for it. Quine, in a sense, was more radical. He didn't believe in necessity, so there was no reason to have a theory of it. But the logical positivists thought that mathematics and logic were necessary, which Quine denies. Okay, so really we're interested in explanations of this necessary connections. And so we're going to ignore conceptual semantic issues in what follows. So it's a bit unlike this, the other material about the dependence constraint on our thinking. So that's not really what I'm thinking about today. It's just this metaphysical problem. Okay. Now, so there's a number of people been writing, and they've been shooting at non-naturalism with this objection. They've been saying, G. Moore can't explain necessary connections between moral and natural facts and properties, and that's an objection to the theory, and it explains why it's a bad theory. Okay, that's very common these days. Now, one reply by a philosopher called Ian McFetridge. He published a paper in 1985. You may not have heard of Ian McFetridge. He taught at the University of London, and he didn't live very long. He died in about 1990, 1980. And I'm his only doctoral student, so he was quite young at the time. And I got a doctorate with him, and then soon after that, he
got
doctoral degree, so okay. I'm his PhD student. But soon after I got my doctorate, he's a great guy.
The first and the last doctors.
Yes, of McFetridge. He was a very nice man. There's a whole story there. His theory, he had a thought about this. We talked about it a bit together, but it's his idea. He said, well, the question is, you explain these necessities. There are necessary connections, right? And you have to explain some of them. Well, how do you explain a necessary connection? Well, if you think about it quite generally, how do you explain anything? And sometimes you explain something in other terms. So you could explain why this is necessary in terms of that, or that is in terms of that. But eventually, at some point, you just have to accept a brute necessity, a basic kind of necessary connection, and explain other things in terms of it. So he thought that some things you just have to accept, some very basic necessities, as brute or basic or fundamental, and they can explain other necessities, but some must be basic. I don't know, why is it necessary that 2 and 2 is 4? Well, perhaps because it's necessary that 2 is 1 plus 1, and 4 is 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. I mean, you can imagine how it goes, but then there's some basic necessity which explains other necessities. So in a sense, it's a way of rejecting the objection. So this happens quite often in philosophy. You object to something and then you reply by rejecting the assumption of the objection. That's a very usual form of argument. Mm-hmm. And you say, well, it's not an objection. You know, there's a famous example in moral philosophy where have you heard of Jack Smart, the Australian philosopher? Smart. He was a very materialist philosopher. He was also a utilitarian. So he was a utilitarian and thought the right thing to do was have the best consequences. And so people have then objected to him and they said, well, this is not a good theory because it means that sometimes you have to execute an innocent person because it's for the general good. You have to do something unjust because it makes people happy in general. So maybe there's going to be a riot and you do something illegal, you say this person was, you kill or hang an innocent person to stop a big riot where there are going to be a big problems. So utilitarianism implies, so the objection is utilitarianism implies this consequence. Sometimes you have to have an innocent man, but it's not true that you have to, that seems wrong. So utilitarianism is false. And he makes a joke about this, and he says, well, no, I accept this consequence. He implies Q, I accept P, therefore I accept Q. So he says, well, sometimes it is okay to hang an innocent person to stop a riot. That's okay, I accept that. So sometimes a philosopher's objection is no good because you just accept the what the other side thinks is a problem, you say is not a problem. So with the joke then is that one philosopher's modus ponens is another philosopher's modus tollens. Modus tollens, you know this word for, do they know the logical principles? So this is called modus ponens. In logic? Modus ponens? Modus ponens. And this one's called modus tollens. Maybe you have different words. So, you know, some people like beef, other people like chicken, other people like fish. Some philosophers like this form of argument, some philosophers like this form of argument. It's a sort of joke. So similarly, so you, when you philosophers make an objection, sometimes you just, it's not necessarily an objection. So similarly with necessities, some necessities cannot be explained. But that's okay. Why is it a problem? That was McFetridge's view. So, so I think you can go a little further than McFetridge. Ian was his name. He was lots of fun, a very amusing guy, but he had a complicated story. So I think you can go a little further. You can say the necessity is built into the properties. So I think the kind of, you can have a kind of properties. And the kind of properties they are is means that they have a certain necessary structure. So a moral property is just the kind of property which means, which sets up these kind of necessities. Because that's just built into the nature of this property. It's just built into what it is to be a moral property that if something has it and another does not have it, there must also be a natural difference. So it's the metaphysics of the moral property explains these, this pattern of necessities. Okay, so that's sort of a view, I call it brutalism, which is supposed to stop the objection. Stop. No problem here. Well, there's something a bit strange, you might say. Look, I mean, there's something a bit odd. I mean, these people have got a sort of got a point. I mean, you've got a moral property. Suppose there's a moral property you know, you've got a moral property, and suppose that's holds in virtue of some natural property. Maybe something going on in this room here. We're in this room, and suppose I insult my teacher. Suppose I tell you, Ian McFetridge is where he was. Suppose I insult my teacher.
Okay.
That would be, I would do something wrong. That would be this is a negative moral property. So I'm in this room, and then, so you've got a combination here, and maybe a dependence relation. But it means that in a room, on the other side of the world, in the other side of the world from here is probably in the United States somewhere, in 12 hours away in the time zone. I know New Orleans, so it's probably in New York, is about 12 hours away. There could be another room, and there's a philosopher in that room. And that philosopher, why, insults his teacher. Or maybe 2,000 years ago, in ancient China, there was a philosopher who insulted his teacher. That they must necessarily have the same moral value as this insult to my teacher. Well, isn't that strange? So, you've got something happening in this room here, and miraculously, at the speed of light, maybe there's a philosopher on a planet, the other side of the sun. Right. So the speed of light, how long does it take? How long does light take to get to the sun? Is it 6 minutes?
About 6 minutes.
It's about 6 minutes. So here's the sun. And maybe on the planet, maybe Mars, I can support life. So here we are, here's Earth. And maybe Mars is the other side of the sun, so it's 12 minutes away. Well, there's a philosopher on Mars insulting his teacher. And faster than the speed of light. It's fixed that they must have the moral feature. So this one is in New York, and this one is in ancient China, but also on Mars, there's someone insulting his teacher. This is a strange Martian with three eyes, and but they're insulting their philosopher teacher. Faster than the speed of light. It's fixed that if he insulted his teacher, there's this necessary connection. See, I think it's still very weird that how what happens with one thing can affect other things in that way. So there is something strange about this connection of necessities. That's the idea that these people are pushing. That supervenience, the supervenience connection, is puzzling.
I have a question. Sorry.
It's a good time to ask a question, actually, in my where I'm laying things out.
You say one thing such as a student and the other teacher, this is immoral in one place in China or in America or in Mars.
Yeah.
I don't know whether there is something, whether something is immoral in one culture, but it's immoral in another culture.
Okay. I mean, okay, well then things can be culturally, of course things are culturally relative in that sense. If I do this to you,
Mm-hmm.
You think I'm scratching my neck. If I do this in southern Italy, I'm in big trouble.
Yeah.
So, of course, okay, I mean, it could be, so you have to think about, I mean, that raises the question of having specified this one sufficiently to fix a moral property. Actually, there's an interesting question here, because there's one way, if there are two things which are similar naturally, they must be the same morally.
Yes.
Well, they must be the same naturally in all the relevant respects, including the cultural context. So if this is an insult in Italy, but this is an insult in, I don't know, Pakistan, then it's wrong to do that in Italy, and it's wrong to do, and it's okay to do that in Italy, and it's wrong to do that in Pakistan, but not wrong to do that in Pakistan. So you've just got to specify this sufficiently that it's enough to determine the wrongness. But that's why insulting is, I'm not sure, it seems like if I'm insulting my teacher, and of course there can be situations in which it's okay to insult your teacher. Maybe it's part of dialectics. So you learn how to not have to, you might say, right, you're going to come and work with me, and I might say to you, you're too respectful. Right, so you're too respectful for me, you must challenge me. I want you to fight me. So I might say, you've got to fight me, if you're because otherwise you end up believing, sometimes graduate students end up believing everything their teachers believe, which is not good. So I say, right, I want you to insult me for 5 minutes. I could do that, because it might be good for you. So that would be adding some of the context here, in which, but if it's really, is she really insulting me? Maybe she is. But it's interesting that this version, when people state supervenience, it can be, if you've got things which are similarly, let's do it in the mind-body case. So suppose you said, this is the analogy of your argument. If you've got two brains which are the same, then they are thinking the same thoughts. Right, well that's exactly denied by Kripke and Putnam, because they say what's relevant is the brain plus the environment. So similarly, in your case, it's not just the insult, it's the insult plus the cultural context. But someone like Putnam or Kripke, they're not denying that meaning depends on something, they're just denying that it depends on the brain. Meaning isn't in the head, but it's in the head plus more. So similarly, your insult could depend on the cultural context plus more.
Oh, okay, okay.
Maybe I'll leave it on that.
Yeah, got it. Thank you.
Okay. Now, let's do some metaphysics. There's this principle, which is that there are no necessary connections between distinct things. And that's called Hume's principle. And it has played quite a big role in philosophy. There are no necessary connections between distinct things. It's called Hume's principle. Because Hume says something like that. And it's been quite influential in philosophy, from David Hume, but also you get something similar in Wittgenstein's Tractatus. Each atomic fact is distinct from the other atomic facts, and they can vary independently of each other. But this is the world according to Wittgenstein. Right, this is Wittgenstein's world. And what happens here, you can have a fact there, and that can obtain, or it's a P, you can have P, or you can have not P there. Here's another one, here's another fact. Q. You can have Q or you can have not Q. And the world is this kind of structure. But everything is an atomism here, like logical atomism, like in Russell. Each fact is separate and can obtain or not obtain independently of other facts. So it's a very common idea. So it gets to be called Hume's principle. But I think that it's very likely that this principle is false. And actually Wittgenstein came to reject it in his later period of by about 1930, 31, 32. And he comes to reject this idea, which was in the Tractatus. But also, it's also in Russell. But in a sense, it's, you see, the Russell, and it comes in Hume, so it might be a sort of part of the empiricist tradition in many ways, part of the metaphysics of British empiricism, perhaps. I'm just guessing that. But here are some examples, here are some problems for it. So there's a recent philosopher I'm attacking called Tristan McPherson here. So he's got, in 2008, I'm actually attacking this guy's version of this. But there's some problems trying to understand. I'll tell you what the problem is in what you're reading here, is there's a notion here, which if I had more time, I would correct. I use a notion called wholly distinct here in this paper, which is not really explained. So this is not published, this paper. I'm still working on it. So if you find something strange in here, when I get to the notion of wholly distinct, as opposed to non-identical, I don't really explain it. So I know, I'm aware that this is a weakness in what I've written here, in what you're reading there. If you just to warn you, if you get to that point and you go like that, then that's okay. But the fact is also that there are many people I'm reading and discussing now, and they also use it in that way. So it's taken me a while. I've been reading a lot of people in the last, have written on this in the last 8 years, and they all use this notion without explaining it, which is very frustrating. But I've now realized that it's systematically frustrating. Okay. But anyway, we'll come to that. But let's assume that the basic idea is there are no necessary connections between distinct things. Well, here's one example we've had a few times. This is a Kit Fine example, sets and their members. So you have a set is an abstract object, and it has members. So you can have a set of everything on this table, cups, my watch, throat pastels, everything, a computer. And then those are all the things on the table, a collection, and then there's an abstract object, which is the set of them. Just like you can have a set of numbers, you can have a set of things on this table. But the members, the set is necessarily related to the members of the set. But yet they are distinct things. A set is an abstract object, has no causal powers, whereas the things on this table have causal powers. So that's one example. Here's another example. So that's an example which people come up with. This is an example which is my example. So it's my own example. Numbers, according to Platonists, about mathematics. You know, some people are Platonist about mathematics, which means that they think that numbers are real and they exist, but they are not physical. They are abstract objects. But there are numbers form a sequence. So there's the counting numbers, the whole numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. And they form an infinite sequence. Right? But yet, the number one is not the same thing as the number 5 or 7. They're distinct things. Each of them is things, is a thing, but they are distinct from each other. But they're still necessarily connected. So there are necessary relations between distinct numbers. So for example, 4 is a whole counting number necessarily between 3 and 5. It's not possible that the number 4, you know, actually it's between 3 and 5, but it could have been between 11 and 13. That would be possible. No, that's not possible. So there's the kind of fixed sequence which is necessary. So I think I'm not sure where I've got this from. Maybe there's a view called structuralism. But suppose you're a mathematical realist. I mean, it's a kind of weird idea here. I mean, isn't this crazy? I'm a mathematical realist. But there's only one number, the number 7. All the other numbers are fictions, just the number 7.
That's a more reasonable assumption is zero.
You could say 0 is the only number, yes, that's true. Of all numbers, it would have to be 0 rather than 1. But it seems that, you know, they are a structure. It's like a pattern. It's like a waffle. I've just come up with that analogy now. A waffle, when you eat a waffle, it's got the square pattern. It's like all the numbers come together, connected. They're all, I'm not sure, or maybe like a web. There's a sort of, they all come interconnected, necessarily interconnected. So where you've got one, they all come. And so you have an infinite sequence. So that's the mathematical Platonist view, and it seems like you've got necessary connection between distinct things. Now, they might say, so I'm attacking this argument against Moore. Now these people might say, okay, give me a break. You're right about these cases. They might say that. I give you these cases because they are abstract objects. And they might say, well, look, these are very strange things, abstract objects, sitting in the sky, sets, numbers. Who knows about the metaphysics of this weird reality beyond the physical world? Who knows what to think? Maybe you're right that there are these necessary connections between distinct things in that weird world of abstract objects. They might say that. But when it comes to this world, the non-abstract world, something like this principle is plausible here for non-abstract things. So they might say that in reply to these two examples. I think it's a bit weird, actually, because then you've got... So I still think you have a strange idea that there are some rules for some kind of things and other rules for other kinds of things. I mean, you know, that seems to me odd. It seems to me there should be a unified general principle for things that exist, whether or not, whatever kind of thing they are. But they might say, well, you know, I don't know what they say, but they might just say, well...
And that's fair, it's not quite strange. Because, you know, abstract things and concrete things in according to some theory, they are different, so essentially. Abstract things and have no, there's no causal efficiency.
That's right.
But concrete things are different, so abstract things like the editor or executive of philosophy standpoint.
Yes.
They think that abstract things in code properties are the kind of things that just exemplify properties. They are
yes.
quite different.
Right. So, they are very different. They are very, very different, it's true. Mm-hmm. But are they different about something so fundamental as identity? Yeah. Okay, well let's go with them. Let's say, okay, they're different because the moral qualities hold of things, of non-abstract things. Hardly anyone thinks, apart from Plato, I think, that abstract things probably have moral qualities. I think Plato does think that. Plato is very weird sometimes, but wonderful too. Because he thinks the forms have moral qualities. The forms are abstract things. Anyway. Let's just look at the non-abstract world. So there's some other examples I've got here. So constitution, the relation between this table and its what it's made of. Most people think that's not identity, because the table and the stuff it's made of have different modal properties, different properties. One could be, they probably weigh the same, but one has, being a table has different, could have been composed of something different, whereas the wood could not have been composed of something different. So there are different properties that, so that's a common example in philosophy of constitution. And that looks like it's not identity, because the table and what it's made of, or the ship and what it's made of, have different properties. As therefore, by Leibniz's law, it's not identity. And yet there are necessary connections. If you burn the wood, if you destroy the wood, necessarily you destroy the table that it makes up. Here's another example, what are called determinates and determinables. Different, being a certain shade of colour, scarlet, and being red. Being a monkey and being an animal. These are necessarily connected, but it's not identity. There are many other kinds of animals besides monkeys, but necessarily a monkey is an animal. But being a monkey and being an animal, they're not the same property, they're not the same kind of thing. Necessarily, red is a colour, but red is not the same thing as being coloured. It could be blue. So, again, that looks like a case where there are necessary connections between distinct, non-abstract properties. Here's another example. This is given to me by a Reading philosopher, because I gave this paper in Reading. This came from the audience. So sometimes I will steal things from you. Sometimes stealing is okay. Teaching methods, teaching materials, stealing is absolutely fine. So someone asked this question. David Odeberg asked this, make this point.
David is Dr. Tan's supervisor.
Yeah, he's a crazy essentialist. I like him. Mm-hmm. He likes a lot. He agrees with all this. He agrees with my framework generally. I look at fine, very much so. But his example is a negative features: being water and not being metal. So those are necessarily connected properties. If something's water, then necessarily it's not made of metal. But they're distinct properties, but yet necessarily related. Here's another case. and this is a case that Wittgenstein was interested in. Being completely red and being completely green. Right. So these being red and green are different colors, but they exclude each other. So color exclusion. One color excludes another. But that being green is not the negation or the contradictory property of being red. And yet there are necessary connections between them. So Wittgenstein actually changed his philosophy because of that example. So this topic we're considering now is actually quite a big one. It's quite a big topic. So it takes you, it takes you from one view of the world to another, from an empiricist view to a less empiricist view, perhaps. Other examples that you have, the Kripke example, which there's been recent papers on this. There's some young philosophers have been writing about this recently. But this Kripke example that human beings have necessary origins. So your parents, you are necessarily the child of your parents. You could not have had other parents. You could not have been you with different parents. That's a point Kripke argues in Naming and Necessity.
How about quite radical kids also from Frege and Kripke? If A is equal to B, it's true. It's true. You know, A and B are quite distinct two things.
Yeah.
But A is being not identical to B is necessary truth. And the property is a necessary property.
Okay. Not being identical
yeah.
to B.
Not being identical.
Yes, it's a good one, yeah. Yes. That's right. I've come across that. Is that, that's in Frege, is it?
Yeah.
It's related to Frege, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
That's
the
right.
First passage.
That's right. That's right. And here's an example of mine. So you have lakes and mountains, we call them the tarn, and they're formed by glacial action. So it's necessary that that lake has its origin in that glacier movement of that glacier. Anyway, the point is there seem to be lots of examples here, counterexamples. So what's going on? So is there anything to be said for Hume's principle? So I think we should reject it. But what's going on? Sometimes you need a diagnosis of what's going on. At the moment you've got a principle, and then you've got lots of counterexamples to it. But that's not really enough to really understand it. So what I think is going on here, and I'm also, this is something my old teacher recommended in this paper he wrote. He only wrote 5 papers because he died very young. There was stuff published after his death. Is that what's going on here is an assumption about the connection between moral realism, this non-naturalism, and modal anti-realism. So accepting Hume's principle is accepting an anti-realist view of necessity and possibility, modality. That was his analysis, and I think it's an interesting... I think I just accept it. So when people are objecting to moral realism, they are accepting a modal anti-realist principle. So what is modal anti-realism? And what is modal realism? Well, I would define modal realism not like David Lewis. So that's really completely the opposite of modal realism, David Lewis. Because that makes a modal property into a relation between things and very similar things. Whereas the idea is that there are modal properties of things which hold, I mean, it's connected with their non-modal properties, perhaps. So this water has the modal property of maybe possibly putting out fire. Something like that, it has. But there's a possibilities that it has. But that's because of how it is, not to do with any relation between this thing and other possible, and things like it in other possible worlds. So I think the Lewis view is very implausible. And in fact, it's a way of reducing modality to relations among actual things. There being a modal property means that this thing is water is kind of wet or has these qualities, but it also has these modal properties, being necessarily this and being possibly that, which it has in virtue of how it actually is. So there's a relation between its actual and its modal properties and its non-modal properties. But there's no reason to think that the only necessary properties this thing has is a relation to itself, which would be identity. I mean, the idea is that of this principle is that only identity is responsible for necessary connections, whereas a modal realist would say there are lots of necessities beyond identity, which of course relate one thing to another. That's what modal realism would be. You define it in terms of properties, but not relations. So sometimes this might seem strange to you if you've studied David. Have you all studied David Lewis's crazy views as an undergraduate? Or you've come across David Lewis's modal realism? Have you?
Part of.
Yeah.
In our reading group, that's the philosophy forum where we made David Lewis the first chapter. Another paper by a young scholar from Singapore, maybe. Possible Girls. It's a very fantastic.
Okay,
if you are thinking of a possible girl, which is your...
Oh, the possible girls, that's right, yes.
And then you have one.
Yeah. Yes. So, suppose... See, Lewis's view, I've put this to some of his students and they agree with me, Ted Sider and people like this. So take morality. Suppose I said, I'm a moral realist. I'm a moral realist. Being right or wrong consists in what people in a certain society think or feel. You think, no, that's not moral realism. That's kind of social relativism or something like that. But similarly, if you think about modality, if I say, well, what's being possibly or necessarily something? Well, it's a relation between this thing and other things very like it in other possible worlds. No, that's just as anti-realist as the view about morality. It doesn't consist in that kind of relation. The modal property, like the moral property, is more like an intrinsic property of the thing. It has it. For example, the window has dispositional properties in virtue of its structure, and it also has modal properties. That window can break quite easily. If I throw a chair at it, it will break. It possibly will break. But that's because, I mean, what explains that possibility is what it's made of, not some relation that it stands in. Now, it might stand in some relation because of how it is, but the modal property, if you're a realist about modality, it's an intrinsic view. The modal properties depend on its intrinsic properties in many cases. There are some cases like a key can open a door, and then it's the key can open the door partly in virtue of how the key is. It's not made of rubber. And also the shape of the lock on the door. So the view then is that if you're a modal realist, you will just reject this principle, and it will explain why you think that the Hume's principle is false. So modal realism is an anti-realism. Modal anti-realism is a very counterintuitive view. It's a very strange view. There are not really necessities and possibilities in the world. So that's an incredibly not plausible view, which is assumed by these people arguing against moral realism. So why do we have to be persuaded by them? We don't. And that's all I've got to say today.
I think if we suppose that God exists and our actual world is created by God, then this is just this is actuality. But other possibilities correspond to different possible worlds. Then in our world, we say that it's not broken, but we say that it might break. Then we believe that. In God's mind, there's another world.
In God's mind?
Yeah.
But then it comes back to the question of fiction, doesn't it? When you say someone is thinking something, you know, does it mean that thing exists?
The actual world is just one entity in God's mind. God's mind.
Yeah.
So if so, then maybe they lose the area of. The modal realism might be not too quite to explain, if we suppose.
Well, you would have to have. It depends whether you think things in your mind exist. If you're mind-on, you would have to be mind-on. Because with mind-on, if you think of something that doesn't exist, in some sense it does exist.
Maybe we do not have to use beings in a subject's mind, just a. We can understand God's creation in the literal science. The world is created by God,
yes.
And this is the actual world.
Yes.
But there are other worlds which exist, but they are not actual.
Yes. Why is that?
Since they are just not actual.
Why talk in that way? Why accept that there are
because
other worlds?
Because from some assumption of. Religion, that our world is just one of the best, or the best among all the possible worlds. But if it's just one,
yes,
it doesn't mean that there are no other possible worlds. So
this world, yeah,
I mean,
yeah. What is true is that this world could have been better. By the way, I've got a story to tell here. I went to the World Congress of Philosophy in Athens, and they gave a special speech. I think one of your colleagues was there at the place where the academy was of Plato and Aristotle, and they found out where it was, and they had two lectures on that place. I think 2,400 years after the academy in ancient Greece was formed, they think they found the very place, and so we had a big lecture there, and maybe thousands of people. 1,000 philosophers was there from all over the world. And there were two speeches. One was by an Italian called Berti, and he went first. And so, of course, being in Greece, they wanted to be, they wanted everyone to talk about how wonderful ancient Greek philosophy was, of course, because this was Greece. So the first one, he praised Aristotle. He was an Italian guy, and he was written there sort of more like the continental tradition, but he was very interesting, he was very scholarly, and everything came down to Aristotle. Aristotle was right about everything. He wasn't very enthusiastic about analytic philosophy, except for four people, and they were mostly, he was from the Catholic tradition, and he mentioned Geech, Anscombe, someone else, and E.J. Lowe. And so I wrote by, and E.J. Lowe was very ill then, he died soon after that, and I wrote to him from this, and I said you were mentioned as one of the four relevant philosophers. It made him very happy, apparently, and he was in hospital. The second philosopher was a Japanese philosopher who does Plato, from Keio University, who's my friend, called Noboru Natomi. And I got to know him in Japan, one of the first times I went to Japan for philosophy, and he's my friend, because he helped me once. I was with some very important people from my university, the dean of, and we went out for a meal, and in Japan you go out for a meal with sort of Japanese food, and I had sake. Hello. I had sake and beer together. Anyway, so I mixed these two drinks, and he helped me very much because it had this effect on me. Anyway, so he helped me very much. So he was my friend, because otherwise I would make embarrassment of myself. So he helped me a lot because these two drinks mixed very badly. Anyway, so he did one of the speeches there. This is relevant to your question. And he said, in Japan, during the Second World War, many of the philosophers started working on Plato. Suddenly, they were doing Plato. Strange. Why? Most of these philosophers, these are university academics. So they were politically against the fascist militarism of the Japanese government in the wartime and just before the war. So they were against that. But of course, incredibly dangerous to say anything or do anything. Unbelievably difficult. So they started working on Plato. Part of the reason for that was that in Plato, and this was his bit for saying that Plato was just as important as Aristotle, or different from Aristotle, because in Plato, it's crucial for Plato, and this is the reason they were doing it, and they found out later there was lots of writings about this, was the actual world. But the actual world could have been better. There is a better world, or there's an ideal world, and our world falls short of the world as it ought to be. So there's the world as things should be, and there's the world how things are. And in Aristotle, if you like, they're too closely connected. Whereas this idea of an ideal, which for them was very important in the wartime, because some of these people hated what was happening. Mm-hmm. During the war they were working on Plato.
Or before?
And I don't know when it started. I would have to ask him about this, when they started working about this. But they were always, you know, they're philosophers, so they're kind of politically, they're not in line with them. I mean, of course, like in Germany, there was Heidegger supporting the government, the Nazis. But there's mostly the academics tend to not like that kind of thing. So this world here, there's the actual world, and there is a, well, what do we say about this? So here we are. I mean, there's the world of how things are, and there's the world, there's how things should be. You know, I should pay back some money I have borrowed or something like that, but I might not do it. So there's, do we want to say, well, no, I actually did pay back the money. But so we want to say something like, the world is what it is, but it could have been better. You see, the Platonist view is sort of strange though, because it says, well, actually things are better. There really is a better world. No, you want to say this thing has modal properties. Properties. You want to say you want to say this is the world of where things are better. You want to say that this thing is you want to say this is what McGinn thinks, Colin McGinn. You want to say that X is F. You could say that, or you could say, but what does that mean? X is actually F, and then you can say X is possibly F. So that this is here, which is qualified by actually or possibly or necessary. So it's a question of the logical form. So you're not saying that F. You're not saying that X stands in some relation to something quite different. You're saying that X is F. And I don't know how Chinese works with this word for predication. You have a word for predication. Ship. So this, but this is qualified with actually, necessarily, or possibly. And that's the logical form of a modal claim. Rather than saying there is a world, this is David Lewis, there is a world, another world, a distinct world from this world, and in this other world the thing is F, because then you haven't seen the correct logical form for modal thought. So this is an argument against your suggestion. So let's go back to your theology example. God could have chosen to create another world. Things could. This world, no, there are no other worlds. God couldn't have created other worlds because there's only one world. God could have created this world with different properties. That's not a different world. Instead of this, God could have made this purple or red rather than white. That's not saying there's another world in which this thing or something just like it is purple. That's crazy. That's David Lewis. That's mad. He could have made this thing. This is Kripke's objection to Lewis. Kripke's exactly right in Naming Necessity. The modal properties are properties of this thing. They're not the properties of something like it. There are particular things. Unless you think that there are no particular things and there are just sort of patterns in the world. No, there are some distinct things which have hexaity properties, the property of being that very thing. So Nixon could have won or could have lost. That's true of Nixon. It's not true of someone just like him. So the possible worlds, bad idea, I think. And they, is in a sense, it's a form of anti-realism about modality. And actually Lewis admits that. He says, I'm a Humean. Well, if you're a Humean, you're really against morality, moral thinking, you're against modal thinking, or you've got an interpretation of it whereby it's not really factual thinking. And in a sense that, you know, I mean, Lewis, he's a student of Quine, you can never forget that. And Quine, you know, Lewis's view is like Quine's except with more objects. But there are no, it doesn't mean, the fact that you have more objects in Lewis, possible objects, doesn't mean there are more, you're admitting modal properties. So, maybe in Lewis you get something a bit like modality, but it's really a substitute. I mean, it's quite clever, you know, from a universal quantification, you get an existential quantifier. So all sheep are white, it follows that there is some sheep that is white. And so from necessarily P, it implies that possibly P. So some things are sort of parallel to what you get in modal logic. But I wonder if, I'm not sure if there's some things which don't come out correctly. I just have to see. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, if we consider your topic today, that help understand the moral necessity or moral dependence of, for example, X has a moral property of being M, is dependent or necessitated by X being M.
Yeah.
Or then if we suppose David Wilson's theory or the Gaussian picture, then we might say that such a principle is valid in every world created by God.
That's right. So God is constrained. Yeah. If God's creating the world, he cannot create two things which are different morally but the same naturally. God cannot do that.
Yeah, I think we should say that God created this actual world.
Yeah.
This is what we can say, but this doesn't mean that God did not create animals. He just created this actual world,
right.
And at the same time, other equally possible worlds.
That's right.
But they are not actual.
That's right. I mean, in saying that, you're against Descartes' view, because I think in Descartes' view, God can create impossible worlds, because I think for Descartes, God creates necessity, necessary facts as well, which is a really strange view. But I think, yeah, God could create different things, but he cannot violate necessity. So God cannot make 2 and 2 5. And similarly, if there are two things naturally similar in the sufficient extent, that if one has a moral feature, then so does the other. So God can't. So here's the actual world. You've got an M in a moral natural combination. This is the actual world. Let's talk in terms of actual world. And here's a possible world. Here. Okay. God cannot create this world. God cannot do that. God is banned from doing this. And so this is actually how Blackburn sets it up. And then the puzzle is, why not? So that's a way we can set up the puzzle from which I began. Just like that. Easy. You say, supervenience really tells God what he can and cannot do. Tells God that he can make another. Here's another possible world. Possible world two. He can make this world. He can make lots of worlds where you have this combination. But he can't make any possible world like this. Or he cannot make a possible world in which something is M at T and is not M at a later time, but it's changing morally, and yet it's N at that time, but it carries on being N at a later time. God cannot do that. Now you might think, so one of the ways that Blackburn sets up the problem is saying, well look, why not? You know, God should be able to do anything. But he can't create, and I suppose that here's the principle here, God cannot create anything contrary to the laws of logic. But the supervenience principle is not a principle of logic, but it's still a principle of necessity built into those properties. And God still can't do anything against that. Like, so that would be, here's an analogy, God can't create you with different parents. You necessarily have the parents that you have. God just can't do that. But of course that's not a logical necessity, because that's the necessity of origin. It's a metaphysical principle of persons.
Because here you're supporting generic dependence or rigid dependence. The person's dependent on this parents or
yes.
Just his parents. His parents might, there might be another male and female.
Yes.
They marry and then still give birth to him. So generic or rigid.
No, they couldn't. Another parent, different parents, could not give rise
so,
to a particular
agree
person.
With Kripke, right?
Yeah, no, I'm agreeing with Kripke, yes. So it's a rigid. Of course, yeah, in a sense, we're talking about a person where we pick them out as having, with a name, not a description. The student sitting in that chair would be a non-rigid description. The student who was sitting in that chair could have had other parents. But, well, actually that's ambiguous. But the student who, if there's someone, yeah, you see what I mean. I mean the necessity is holding of the individual. But of course another student could be sitting in that chair with different parents. So there are restrictions on this ban of. So there, it seems like there are restrictions on which other possible worlds are like, which do not derive just from logical combinations. And that's the whole point of the Tractatus vision, isn't it? Let's go back to the Tractatus, where you've got pictures of the world, and these are logical atoms, right? This is the Russell Wittgenstein picture, and each one of them is logically independent of the others, but it seems that there are other kinds of necessities, constraints on what's possible besides just what you get from logic of and or and not and if then. Those are not the only restrictions on what is possible. So there's more than logical necessity. Must be. There must be more than logical necessity.
Suppose there's only one correct logic. Say classical.
I mean, there must also be something like metaphysics. There must be metaphysical principles that transcend any logic. You probably haven't seen the characters, have you? A principle. Unless you want to say this, it depends what you mean by logic. Take a temporal logic. So there's a logic of before and after, and now. So there's a philosophy of the logic which Arthur Pryor discusses, or there's a logic of deontic logic of ought and permission. So it depends, I mean, in that sense of logic, where there are specific logics, then there are necessities which are part of that logical system, but they're not part of basic logic, or with which involves quantification and identity. So there are metaphysical principles, which are, it shows that when you're thinking about, there are metaphysical principles behind any specific logics that you choose. So if you choose axioms of deontic logic, it's because you're making metaphysical assumptions about morality. If you choose axioms for modal logic, you're making metaphysical assumptions about modality. So logic, what are the boundaries of logic? There's narrow logic, but then there's logic in the broader sense. I mean, in Marxism, you have the logic of capitalism. And, that's not even a proposition. So the notion of logic is not necessarily so narrow as, I mean, there's basic logic that you do in philosophy courses, but then there's noble logic and other kinds of logic, probabilistic logic, evidential logic, epistemic logic. Why are those not logic?
Papa, question. How to define the moral property? Can you give some examples? What is a moral property?
Yeah, I haven't talked about that. Yeah, I mean, I think I have. So here, in this thing, I talk about this on the first page. So I'm just defining it as by examples, as properties like good and evil, virtue, justice. I take those to be moral properties. So, but I mean, I've only been talking about moral properties, but actually everything I've said today applies to epistemic properties and other normative properties as well. Practical rationality. But I take what is a moral property is a very difficult question. And people used to discuss it in the 1960s and 70s, and then they stopped discussing it. And I'm slightly embarrassed, I have no good answer.
What I want to say is, maybe these moral properties can be divided into several classes or layers. I can draw two pictures.
Yeah, please. Okay.
Because I think of coin, however, think the knowledge has some classes. Maybe the core is the logic knowledge, okay, and then is the physics knowledge, and then chemistry, and so on. I think this knowledge maybe changed as the time or our scientific has developed, but the logic knowledge maybe it is the core, it is very hard. It's not easy. Yes. Maybe I think the proper moral properties kind of similar to it. There is some moral properties is very core in the heart, and then some moral properties is very easy can be changed.
Yeah.
And then it's this thing is not necessarily
So he's talking about the structure.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. In North Slovenians all connect to the natural property.
Yeah.
I just guess it.
Yeah, I think that's plausible. There are some central moral concepts. And in fact, this idea of a thick concept I was talking about yesterday is precisely those are changeable. So we think that piety is not quite, you know, or chivalry. These are old, some people think these are old-fashioned notions and moral notions that should change. Whereas notions of right and wrong action, it's difficult to see how they should, they seem to be very central. I think that's right. There are more justice, it seems we need that notion that's in between.